Both Turtle Bay and Ruby Fruit Jungle share the same history in that the entire block of Decatur Street in the 1100 block was once convent property. It belonged to the Ursuline Convent and was used as a hospital for yellow fever victims. During the 1700s and 1800s, yellow fever was a very mysterious disease. People died by the thousands here in New Orleans, so of course we needed a large hospital facility, and this is what it served as. The courtyard in Turtle Bay was actually used as part of a cemetery for the yellow fever victims in the early 1700s.
We were absolutely a penal colony. And the idea of vampires coming to New Orleans is something that's very, very much rooted in our history. Part of the early problem with founding the city of New Orleans is that we had no women at all. It was so bad that the men were running off into the bayous and being killed and eaten by the local Indians trying to find Indian women. So they began to try and figure a way to get large numbers of women here. They had limited success until they finally realized that simply just lying was the way to go. They put posters that showed this beautiful city of gold, literally almost with cobblestone streets that were paved in nuggets. Rich gentlemen. The simple fact is, these women came here. And when they came here, they were issued boxes by the court of France. So this is all history. It's not folklore, it's not legend, it's the history of the place. Boxes we could easily describe as a distressingly familiar size.
These ladies were called casket girls because they came to this country with large wooden boxes that vaguely resembled coffins. They were actually brides for the settlers. They were housed and educated by the Ursuline nuns and eventually married off to the settlers in the city.
They'd gotten as close. The first shipment of casket girls got as close as Mobile, Alabama, a few days down the coast. But while they jumped ship, because they were told it was waiting for them here, the ship and its cargo came to the city of New Orleans, and the only men who didn't know everything had changed were the extremely violent, extremely superstitious, and heavily armed men of the city of New Orleans. These men, instead of pretty girls, watched boxes of a distressingly familiar size getting unloaded and laid in gleaming rows to only be picked up by the last people they ever would have expected to come for them, agents from the Catholic Church. They were taken and they were placed inside the convent's attic. But at that point, the city of New Orleans begins to get its vampire legends.
It has become our vampire folklore that suggests that these women are responsible for bringing the vampires from Europe here to New Orleans. It's pretty easy to understand if you look at what was going on in France at the time. The Inquisition was still quite alive and well during the early 1700s. In fact, they were kind of winding down on the witch hunts and the witch burnings at that time, and the church had started the vampire hunts of the Inquisition. They were breaking open graves, cutting off heads, burning bodies. So of course, these settlers coming from a culture where the talk of vampires was very, very commonplace, it's easy to understand that when they see a group of women coming in carrying large coffin-like boxes, that the talk of vampires would spread through the streets of New Orleans very early on in the 1700s. Where it becomes particularly interesting, though, is that that section of Decatur Street, where Turtle Bay and Ruby Fruit Jungle are located, by 1989, that became the vampire capital of the United States.
It makes you wonder very much, though, if this is just all a strange coincidence in that the vampire subculture that started in New Orleans really blossomed in the late 1980s has a strange resonance with the legend of vampires in the attic of an old convent. Who could say?
You're watching Haunted New Orleans.
O'Flaherty's was always one of the great Irish pubs. Now this city, of course, being the second largest point of Irish immigration in the United States, second only to New York City. A lot of people don't realize that. And it was top 10 list of Irish pubs to go to in the United States. John and Mary Wheaton purchased in 1803 the building after the Louisiana Purchase. They were Americans. They moved down here and John passed away. Later on, after her period of mourning, Mary Wheaton would take up with a Joseph Baptandier. And she did not realize that he was engaging in plissage. Plissage is where you would take a young woman of color and use her as a mistress and bestow upon her wealth and things like that. And, you know, and then you more romance and you had the steady relationship of the wife and you also had the mistress. Usually it was young men who were doing this, not married men. So it was fairly scandalous. So when this mistress, Angelique, came to his house, luckily Mrs. Wheaton was away, or Mary Wheaton was away, but the husband did not take to this kindly at all, risking the whole thing, and she threatened to expose the entire affair. And they broke into a row, It became violent. He wound up throwing her from the interior balcony. She fell down. Her head contacted the edge of the well, which is now a fountain there, and snapped her neck clean. And she lay there. She died right there on the spot, killed, dead. He ran down quickly, grabbed tools, dragged her body over to the gardens, dug a shallow grave, buried her. And while he's taking a rest, seeing how his work looks and everything like that, he notices the face of a young servant boy who's witnessed the entire event. That young servant boy beats feet, takes off. He realizes the gravity of what he'd done. He goes back inside. His wife will notice, Mary Wheaton will notice his very distant aspect now, and over the next week. And then in the next week, he disappears entirely. And she won't have cause to find him until the following week when she, investigating a foul smell coming from the upper reaches, goes and discovers him where, enacting his own penance, he has hung himself from the neck until dead, and his body is hanging from the rafters. She will never again remarry, and eventually dies there of old age, and I'm sure in great confusion, wondering whatever it was that happened. And the ghosts in the building are Angelique, Mary, and Joseph Bob-Dandier, the husband, the wife, and the mistress. Angelique is experiencing the courtyard. Joseph is experiencing the upper regions and the upstairs areas. And Mary is still seen over what used to be the concert room. She's seen through the windows of the concert room during one particular song, during the song Red as a Rose. All the local people, musicians and whatnot, are so used to seeing her during Red as a Rose, they actually dedicate the song to her. This is Mary's song. It's Mary's favorite song. We hope she finds peace. And people will, who was that woman overlooking, standing up there overlooking? And very often they just say, was that during Red as a Rose? And they're like, oh, well, that was Mary. That was our ghost. One of our ghosts.